Boa tarde a todos. É uma honra para o Ministério de Minas e Energia, para Itaipu Binacional e para o Centro Internacional de Energias Renováveis e Biogás, o CI Biogás, promover esse side event da Organização das Nações Unidas focado no tema Transição Energética e Diversificação de Fontes com o Biogás. Esse evento é um marco do setor e compõe as atividades propostas para um diálogo de alto nível de energia que acontecerá virtualmente em setembro deste ano. Agradeço a presença de todos e, ao final das apresentações, teremos um momento com os palestrantes para responder às dúvidas do público. Gostaria de saudar as autoridades aqui presentes e agradecer a disponibilidade em conversar conosco a respeito desse tema tão importante. Neste momento, passo a palavra para o senhor José Mauro Coelho, secretário de Petróleo, Gás Natural e Biocombustíveis do Ministério de Minas e Energia do Brasil.
O Brasil tem um imenso potencial para a produção de biogás e de biometano. Trata-se de uma oferta descentralizada e distribuída em todo o nosso grande país. Podemos produzir o biogás a partir da digestão anaeróbica de resíduos orgânicos obtidos, por exemplo, a partir do setor de saneamento, do setor de alimentos ou do setor sucroenergético. O biogás pode ser utilizado para gerar eletricidade e também para obtenção de biometano através de processo de purificação. Já o biometano, por sua vez, pode substituir o gás natural em todas as aplicações. Cabe ressaltar que o gás metano é o principal componente do biogás e, quando lançado na atmosfera, contribui mais para o aquecimento global do que o gás carbônico. Por isso, a utilização do metano é crucial para mitigar o aquecimento global e as mudanças climáticas. O Plano Decenal de Expansão de Energia 2030, o nosso PDE, considera como principais fontes de produção de biogás no país a vinhaça e a torta de filtro provenientes do setor da cana-de-açúcar. Nesse sentido, em 2020, foram processadas no Brasil cerca de 660 milhões de toneladas de cana, e em 2030 serão mais de 800 milhões de toneladas. Cada tonelada de cana gera até 40 quilos de torta de filtro, e para cada litro de etanol produzido, temos até 12 litros de vinhaça. Dessa forma, de acordo com o PDE, o Brasil tem potencial para produzir 471 bilhões de litros de vinhaça e 33 milhões de toneladas de torta de filtro em 2030. Assim, somente a partir da vinhaça e da torta de filtro do setor sucroenergético é possível atingir a produção de 19 milhões de metro cúbico por dia de biogás. Por sua vez, a energia elétrica proveniente dessa fonte pode atingir 2 gigawatts no horizonte decenal. Mas o biogás já é uma realidade no Brasil. Temos atualmente 675 plantas produtoras, gerando cerca de 5 milhões de metro cúbico por dia e produzindo 330 mil metro cúbico dia de biometano. E, sem dúvida, essa produção se tornará ainda mais importante nos próximos anos. Por fim, hoje vocês terão a oportunidade de conhecer um projeto muito interessante desenvolvido por Itaipu, que integra a cadeia de produtores de suínos do estado do Paraná à produção de biometano para utilização na frota de transporte. Trata-se de um belo exemplo de solução local para um problema global, com potencial para ser ampliado e replicado em outras localidades. Muito obrigado a todos e um excelente evento.
Muito obrigado, senhor José Mauro. Agora passo a palavra para o senhor Paulo César Rezende de Carvalho Alvim, secretário de Empreendedorismo e Inovação do Ministério de Ciência, Tecnologia e Inovação do Brasil.
O projeto GEF Biogás Brasil é estratégico. Ele atua na área de energia renovável dentro de uma lógica que incorpora investimentos públicos e privados, nacionais e internacionais. Uma parceria que envolve empresas, comunidade acadêmica e científica e tecnológica, instituições do poder público e, principalmente, a parceria privada. Estamos falando na oportunidade de resolver um problema que, em algumas situações, é um problema ambiental, mas que tem um desdobramento com impacto socioeconômico e que gera nota fiscal. As empresas podem resolver seus problemas, economizar energia e mais, oferecer uma alternativa limpa de geração de energia. Essa é uma parceria de futuro e que está inserido, inclusive, no programa Combustíveis do Futuro, liderados pelo Ministério das Minas e Energia. Ou seja, parcerias público-privadas em favor do país, em favor do planeta e, principalmente, com a perspectiva de impactos socioeconômicos e geração de nota fiscal.
Agora, vos apresento o primeiro palestrante, o diretor de coordenação da Itaipu Binacional, General Luiz Felipe Kremer Carbonell, que irá abordar o tema Biogás e o Desenvolvimento Regional e a Diversificação de Fontes.
Senhoras e senhores, boa tarde. Eu gostaria de, em primeiro lugar, agradecer em nome da Itaipu Binacional, em particular seu diretor-geral, João Ferreira, pela nossa participação nesse side event do diálogo de alto nível da ONU, especificamente na parte de transição energética. Como já é de conhecimento, Itaipu é uma produtora de energia limpa e renovável. Nós temos aqui a maior produção acumulada de energia do mundo e acreditamos que ainda por muitos anos continuaremos com esse título de maior produtora de energia do mundo. Essa nossa capacidade de produção está diretamente ligada à qualidade da água que hoje corre pelas nossas turbinas e pela contenção do assoreamento que pode diminuir a capacidade do nosso lago, que é a nossa caixa d'água que nos permite fazer essa grande produção de energia. Obviamente, para que nós possamos tratar do manejo do território, assim como da qualidade da água, a sustentabilidade está no DNA da própria empresa. Nós temos que cuidar do meio ambiente para que nós possamos produzir energia limpa e renovável. Com isso, nós também partimos muito cedo para pesquisas de outras fontes de energia, já porque a nossa característica é de uma empresa produtora de energia. Então, abrimos várias pesquisas, tanto para energias fotovoltaicas, como para bioenergia, para o hidrogênio verde, até mesmo para o estudo de acumuladores de sódio, que seria uma maneira de também não agredir o meio ambiente, e nós podemos contar com essa energia acumulada para uso em alguns elementos, como, por exemplo, unidades isoladas ou comunidades isoladas. Com o crescimento da cadeia de proteínas do oeste do Paraná, que é muito rica na produção de suínos e de aves, nós tivemos que dar uma implementada nas nossas pesquisas relacionadas com a bioenergia, porque essa cadeia de proteína tem como consequência vários subprodutos que fazem uma agressão mais direta ao meio ambiente, que é a preocupação da empresa de conservá-lo o melhor possível para a finalidade do nosso negócio, gerar energia limpa, renovável e com qualidade. Neste caminho, Itaipu desenvolveu com bastante ênfase o trabalho de produção de biogás. Usando o subproduto da cadeia de proteína, nós colocamos unidades pilotos, montamos pesquisas em unidades pilotos para a produção do biogás. E isso deu muito resultado. Não só mostrou que essas unidades pilotos são economicamente viáveis, como também são uma solução para diminuir a agressão do meio ambiente por consequência desse tipo de subproduto. As pesquisas deram tão bom resultado que Itaipu é responsável, inclusive, indiretamente, por várias legislações brasileiras relacionadas com o biogás. Hoje, essas pesquisas continuam, elas estão sendo aprimoradas. Hoje, nós estamos trabalhando, inclusive, com certos subprodutos da própria bioenergia, que podem ser utilizados como fertilizantes. Estamos aprimorando não só a capacidade, como a eficácia e a eficiência dessas mini-usinas. E esperamos que com isso nós possamos colaborar com o desenvolvimento regional e com o desenvolvimento do país. Obviamente que nós temos, como sempre, a preocupação de produzir hoje para garantirmos o futuro, que é o princípio básico da sustentabilidade. E nada melhor do que nós colaborarmos para a mudança da matriz energética brasileira cada vez melhor com energias renováveis e com energias limpas.
Muito obrigado pela sua contribuição. Para contextualizar as atividades realizadas pela Força-Tarefa 37, a Task 37, de bioenergia da International Energy Agency, a IEA, apresento-vos o Sr. Jerry D. Murphy, professor de Engenharia Civil e diretor na MAR-I, Instituto de Pesquisas Ambientais da University College Cork, e representante da IEA na Irlanda.
I'm delighted today to talk to you about biogas. I spend most of my life working on biogas and circular economy systems. I lead the International Energy Agency Bioenergy Task on Biogas. And the work we do is to exemplify as much as possible the applications of biogas in different countries. You cannot compare a biogas system to a wind turbine or a PV array. Its role in life is not purely production of fuel. It fits into systems, and it fits into many systems. So when we are explaining how biogas works, it depends where we want the biogas system to sit. So it could be, for example, that we put slurry into an anaerobic digester and we produce biogas that's used for heat on a farm, but also produces biofertilizer that can go back on the land. And what we're doing there is, number one, we're treating something that has the potential to cause pollution. So if we take in slurry, we mineralize the slurry and produce a biofertilizer that has a better nutrient value. We are also producing a biogas that could be used as a fuel for a tractor or a fuel in the farm. And we're also producing a biofertilizer. So we can see how anaerobic digestion fits into farming. It could also fit in, for example, to a food and beverage industry and the production of alcohol or cheese. We can take the byproducts of the industry and we can digest those byproducts to make biogas. And that biogas can be used to replace natural gas that's in the industry, that is used to evaporate alcohol from stillage or milk powder from milk. So we can reduce the scope one emissions of industry. What we can also do is take the digestate from the biogas plant and put it on the land where the grass grew to feed the cows or where the grain grew to produce the alcohol. So we can reduce scope three emissions. So this is where biogas is different than wood chips. It is a source of energy, but it's also a source of fertilizer. And we've looked at organic farmers who don't use any fossil fuels or any weed killer, and they can put their dungs in a digester to make fertilizer, which can make the land more fertile, which can improve the growth of the organic crops. And we have looked at a case study where we've certified a milk farm at minus 0.82 kilograms CO2 per liter of milk. So we can have a carbon negative farm. So the role of biogas in the energy transition is very much in dealing with hard to abate sector. So if we're looking at agriculture, cattle belch, they belch methane, has a global warming potential of 28. We put the slurry in a tank, it produces methane to the atmosphere. So we can decarbonize agriculture. We can decarbonize industries that have a lot of evaporation processes and a lot of wet organic feedstocks. We can also have a local grid where we might combine anaerobic digestion with PV or with wind turbines so that when the wind isn't blowing and the sun isn't shining, for example, by night, we can use biogas to produce electricity and heat in the local system. When we look at the difference between Europe and Latin America, one of the things we have found is there's great potential for lagoons where you excavate a depression in the ground, you line it, you put in your slurries, you can cover it. But because it's so warm, we can have a far cheaper anaerobic digestion system and produce cheaper biomethane. And that will reduce the levelized cost of abatement, because if you can produce the biogas for a lesser cost, and you're abating carbon, your levelized cost of abatement will drop significantly. So our viewpoint is biogas fits into existing systems. It helps decarbonize them. It's a good transport fuel. I know in Brazil there's a system of grass cuttings used to power trucks. So biogas is the epitome of a circular economy system and fits into many, many systems that are there and hard to abate. And long may the technology prosper. Thank you.
Muito obrigado pelos relatos, professor Murphy. E agora com vocês, Mrs. Charlotte Morton, que é membro da Associação de Digestão Anaeróbia do Reino Unido e da Associação Mundial de Biogás, a WBA. E hoje irá apresentar sua palestra com o título Como o biogás promove a transição energética no mundo.
Hello everyone. I'm Charlotte Morton, the Chief Executive of the World Biogas Association, which is the global trade association for the biogas, landfill gas and anaerobic digestion sectors. Founded in 2016 by national associations from the UK, the USA and Italy, together with 20 founding member companies, our mission is to facilitate the capture and recycling of all the organic wastes that we humans generate globally every year through biogas so that we can prevent the harmful methane emissions they produce and build a high-performing professional industry creating millions of new green jobs. In 4 years, our membership has grown to over 100 organisations from all over the world, including national associations from Latin America, Asia, Africa and Europe. The WBA is a part as an official observer with the UNFCCC, a member of CTCN, CCAC, the Global Methane Initiative, and a partner of the C40 Cities Network. By collecting all organic waste and materials and treating them through anaerobic digestion, which turns them into green gas, bio-CO2, natural fertilizers, and other valuable bioproducts, we can turn a waste management issue into a resource. Humans, directly or indirectly, generate over 105 billion tons of organic wastes globally every year, all of which release harmful methane and other greenhouse gas emissions directly into the atmosphere as they decompose. However, today, only 2% of these are treated and recycled. Over the first decade in the atmosphere, one ton of methane is the equivalent of 86 tons of CO2. If we do not cut methane emissions from organic wastes, then a climate catastrophe is unavoidable. Bodies such as the IEA and the European Commission have been strongly demanding more attention to the methane threat, with the EU having recently published its methane strategy. By managing all organic wastes as important bioresources through technologies such as AD, we can cut global greenhouse gas emissions by at least 10% by 2030, if we start now. From the perspective of the UN Sustainable Development Goals, biogas also helps to achieve 9 of the 17 UN SDGs, such as zero hunger, affordable and clean energy, clean water and sanitation, sustainable cities and communities. Last but not least, especially considering the current global crisis, biogas generates employment. We estimate that 11 to 15 million jobs globally could be created in the biogas industry alone by 2030. In 2019, WBA and its leading members made a commitment, subject to the right policies being in place, to employ our technologies, personnel, and financial resources to recycle all available organic wastes to achieve the full potential of the global biogas industry by 2030. This commitment was presented in the form of a declaration to the UNFCCC at the COP25 meeting in Madrid in November 2019. The WBA will only deliver on its commitment if each country delivers its full potential. For this reason, we applaud programmes such as the Tropicalisation Programme by GEF Biogas Brazil project, aimed at addressing the main market challenges in the Brazilian biogas chain. Brazil represents an enormous opportunity for the global biogas industry, given the size of its agricultural sector, which is the second largest contributor to Brazil's greenhouse gas emissions, and the urgent need to manage urban waste in the country. We particularly welcome the programme's focus on cooperation between national and international companies. knowledge transfer and international industrial partnerships will be essential if we are to grow the global biogas sector. Expertise from Europe, for instance, which remains the heart of the global biogas industry, will allow countries such as Brazil to deliver on their great potential, while providing local and international companies with unmissable business opportunities. We therefore encourage WBA members and companies around the world to seize this fantastic opportunity. Thank you.
Muito obrigado, Mrs. Morton. Agora já pudemos compreender o contexto global do biogás com essas interessantes palestras. E agora vamos abordar o desenvolvimento do biogás no Brasil e os planos para o futuro. Para iniciar o tema, convido o Sr. Rafael Gonzalez, diretor-presidente do Centro Internacional de Energias Renováveis, o CI Biogás, que apresenta a evolução do biogás no mercado brasileiro desde a Rio+20.
Olá a todos, é uma honra e um prazer muito grande estar aqui representando o CI Biogás neste side event de biogás. Temos a honra também de apresentar que o biogás é um ativo energético do nosso país, disponível na nossa matriz, disponível também no nosso planejamento energético brasileiro. E dentro deste contexto, o setor de biogás vem crescendo na ordem de 22% ao ano. É um setor que vem buscando a transformação de passivos ambientais em ativos energéticos, transformando esses resíduos disponíveis em diversos setores da nossa economia numa oportunidade de produzir energia, seja ela elétrica, seja térmica, seja também veicular. Hoje, a nossa matriz de produção já conta com 675 plantas que produzem na ordem de 2,4 bilhões de metros cúbicos anuais. Porém, nós temos ainda um potencial muito maior, um potencial de 82 bilhões de metros cúbicos por ano de produção de biogás nos setores da agropecuária, nos setores sucroenergéticos e também no setor de resíduos sólidos urbanos. É importante destacar que o biogás ele não faz somente frente à transformação do passivo, ou seja, no tratamento do resíduo, mas ele também faz frente na utilização de uma energia renovável, limpa, que permite a descarbonização dos nossos setores no país. E o CI Biogás, constituído por meio da Itaipu Binacional e de um conjunto de atores e instituições na Rio+20, em 2012, venho acompanhando e também impulsionando o desenvolvimento desse mercado no Brasil. É importante também colocar que a Itaipu Binacional, o CI Biogás e outras empresas desse setor vêm criando oportunidades, vêm criando modelos e cases que podem ser replicados dentro do nosso país. É dessa forma que a gente atua, buscando trazer a tecnologia associada e alinhada ao desenvolvimento territorial das regiões que podem produzir biogás, mas associado também ao contexto econômico, trazendo uma bioeconomia, trazendo uma economia circular para o local que se produz o biogás e permitindo, além disso, ter um energético distribuído dentro do contexto da transição energética. Essa energia disponível do biogás pode ser distribuída, pode atender localmente as necessidades de produção, de atendimento à energia e construindo uma nova matriz energética no país. Um destaque que eu coloco como muito importante e gostaria de ressaltar é que o biometano, que é o refino do biogás para um combustível gasoso que permite a atendimento também a veículos pesados e leves e indústrias, ele vem crescendo na medida em que o Brasil vem se tornando também um importante player, um importante país no contexto da utilização de gás na indústria e no setor de transportes. E aí o biometano é uma visão de interiorização do gás natural, já que a gente tem disponível um gás proveniente um gás fóssil proveniente na nossa costa brasileira e o biometano ele vem no contexto da interiorização do gás no país. É dessa forma que a gente vem trabalhando, eu agradeço a oportunidade.
Muito obrigado pela sua contribuição, Rafael. Convido agora o senhor Alessandro Gardeman, diretor-presidente da Associação Brasileira de Biogás, a ABiogás, com o tema O Potencial do Biogás e Seus Atributos.
Hi, it's a pleasure to be here. It's an honor to be attending this side event of the high-level dialogue on energy organized by the United Nations. I want to thank especially the Brazilian Energy Ministry under Minister Bento Albuquerque and also Itaipu for supporting, organizing, and also the invitation. We want to discuss a little bit about biogas. For sure, Brazil has the biggest opportunity worldwide to explore an untapped potential, a unique and non-explored potential. We have only based on waste, be it sanitation and agri-industry, sugarcane, animal protein, corn waste, with non-food disputes, no competition for land, non-indirect use of land. And we have a huge potential to produce more than 100 million cubic meters of methane a day. 100 million cubic meters of methane a day, it's more than the Brazilian natural gas consumption today. With this energy, we could produce almost 70% of the diesel consumed in Brazil and 40% of the electricity in two major issues that Brazil has. Baseload energy, peak shading, that's all our challenge is to use natural gas fired plants, so we would carbonize our emissions, increase our emissions, our average emissions, and we could do this using carbon neutral biogas for peak generation, baseload energy, and also for diesel substitution in our fleets. So transportation, that's another big challenge of other economies. Biogas is part of the solution in Brazil in large scale. So this increase in efficiency increase in agri-industry waste decarbonization is the potential that we have in Brazil. Thank you very much, guys. It's a pleasure. Hope to see you in person next time.
Muito obrigado, Gardeman. E para complementar as informações a respeito do cenário brasileiro, convido o representante da Unido no Brasil e Venezuela, o senhor Alessandro Amadio, que também é diretor do projeto Jeff Biogás Brasil, para relatar a respeito das realizações do projeto.
Thank you very much for the invitation. I would like also to thank the organizer of the high-level dialogue on energy and of the Ministerial Thematic Forum for giving us the opportunity to illustrate the achievement of this project. The project is funded by the GEF, the Global Environment Facility, and is executed by UNIDO and by the Ministry of Science, Technology and Innovation of Brazil. The project began in 2019 and it will end in the end of 2023. The objective of the project is to reduce greenhouse gases emission by consolidating the biogas value chain and promoting application of biogas for energy, mobility solution, fertilizers, and bioproducts. Biogas has a long tradition in Brazil. It is not something new. But in Brazil, we have plenty of players in the biogas sectors, in the private sector, and among national institutions. Therefore, the project is building up on a very fertile substrate, and its role is to act as a catalyst to consolidate and expand value chain and to promote innovative application of biogas and its bioproducts. The project is addressing five key areas instrumental to development of the value chain and to maximize the impact of the project. This includes policies and norms, technology, capacity building, finance, and governance. Halfway through its execution, the project has achieved some quite good results. So far, we have attracted about $8 million in direct investment in the sector of municipal waste management and agro-industry waste management. and much more is expected in the coming 2 years. At the end of the project, we aim to have a larger biogas production in Brazil, but most importantly, a more effective and profitable use of biogas, including biomethane for energy and mobility, as well bioproduct as fertilizers and CO2 for industrial application. We will also have more enterprises, and those will be more competitive. We will have more job and more revenues in the region where the project is working. In conclusion, a proper management of organic waste has a number of positive externalities. It reduces the impact of the agro industry on the environment, but it also supports the transition away from fossil fuel resources. It promotes energy security through a reliable source of energy, and it also boosts decentralization of energy supply and the overall competitiveness on the entire value chain with a steady flow of revenues. A key element to the achievement so far reached is the positive environment that we have found in Brazil. Local and federal governments, as well as the private sector, understood since the beginning the potential benefit of a strong biogas sectors, and are really supporting the project. I would also like to thank you and the UNIDO team and the national expert working on the project, as well as the Ministry of Science and Technology and Innovation. Particularly, I would like to thank Mr. Alvim, the Secretary of Entrepreneurship and Innovation. His vision and support have been key to steer the project where we are now, and it will help to steer the project where we are going to go in the coming 2 years. Thank you.
Muitíssimo obrigado pelas informações, Margarete. Para falar sobre a inovação com biocombustíveis e rotas azuis, convido o senhor Felipe Marques, diretor de desenvolvimento tecnológico do CI Biogás.
Olá. É um prazer estar aqui para conversar com vocês sobre os corredores azuis. No Brasil, somente 8% da nossa população tem acesso ao gás natural. A nossa rede de gás é muito escassa e nossos gasodutos se concentram no litoral brasileiro e parte do estado de São Paulo. A estratégia para levar gás natural para o interior depende do transporte em caminhões, utilizando o GNL ou o GNC, que é o gás liquefeito ou o gás comprimido. Associado a esse custo do gás natural, entram esses custos de compressão, descompressão e outros processos vinculados. Mas o custo maior dentro de todo esse processo está vinculado à questão ambiental. Esses caminhões, hoje, só conseguem rodar no interior do país a diesel, não conseguem rodar a gás. O potencial de produção de biogás brasileira é de 75 milhões de metros cúbicos dia no agronegócio, considerando o setor sucroenergético. Isso, se a gente convertesse em biometano no transporte, seria o equivalente a 45 milhões de litros de diesel. É o suficiente para rodar 81 milhões de quilômetros em estradas. Os corredores azuis são rotas garantidas em gás natural. Usualmente consideram somente esse combustível, o gás natural, mas o Brasil tem um diferencial. Esse diferencial é o pré-sal caipira. O biometano no Brasil está disponível no interior, onde nós não temos o gás natural. Utilizando o gás natural é possível reduzir emissões de carbono. Utilizando o biometano também é possível reduzir emissões de carbono. Porém, o biometano e o gás natural, de forma complementar, podem produzir um resultado muito importante em redução de emissões de gases de efeito estufa. Somente através dessa visão de complementariedade do gás natural e biometano, poderemos ter uma experiência de corredores azuis muito grande no Brasil. Os corredores azuis com biometano e gás natural podem produzir uma redução de emissões na ordem de 242 milhões de toneladas de carbono equivalente nos transportes no Brasil. Esse é um diferencial do nosso país, produzir um combustível de baixa emissão de carbono e associado a serviços ambientais, que de forma complementar ao gás natural consegue produzir uma agenda muito positiva na redução de emissões nos transportes no país.
Hello, y'all. I would like to say we had an error in the transmission, and now we will go to present the speech of Mrs. Margarete Maria Gandini, Coordenadora Geral de Fiscalização of the Economy Ministry, which will present the theme Biomethane as a Fuel for Heavy Trucks Fleet. Okay, I would like to invite Felipe to step in the room.
Hello, Nicolas. How are you?
Hello, Felipe. I'm doing fine. Thank you. I would like to thank you a lot for your presentation on the biomethane in blue corridors. That was really interesting.
Thank you. Thank you. The blue corridors using biomethane and natural gas in Brazil are the best way to get really good results on low carbon economy, considering the transports. We have a lot of possibilities on biomethane in the countryside, and a lot of natural gas available on the seaside near where we send all the products to export. So we consider that's a very good possibility if the agro industry products goes from countryside to seaside using biomethane, and they can come back using the natural gas. So there is a lot of avoided carbon emissions considering this way to deal with the fuel.
Indeed, that's with no question, lots of mitigated carbon there. And it's also important to remind our international participants that Brazil lacks of a railway. Most of our transport of grains is based on wheels, so heavy trucks. And Felipe, this morning I heard about BioLNG, so bio-liquefied natural gas. And there is also some options to use BioLNG directly on the trucks without gasification. Can you contribute a bit on this topic?
Yes, that's also one possibility that we until now we did not experience in Brazil, but there is some nice experiences outside Brazil, and this should be one of the topics on international collaboration between national and international entrepreneurs, considering these possibilities to use the bio-LNG and avoid the costs on regasification of the liquefied biomethane or the liquefied natural gas. That's a really good possibility to make more feasible this transition to a low carbon fleet in Brazil.
Very nice indeed. And it's also important to remember that in the end of the day, everything goes by mitigating carbon and having power density. So BioLNG has a power density really close to gasoline or diesel. So for heavy trucks, that's really important. Felipe, I thank you for your participation now, and I will call now for the transmission of a video from Margarete from the Economy Mystery. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Agora, os nossos palestrantes apresentarão as tecnologias e um prognóstico para o biogás no Brasil. Para iniciar esse bloco, convido a senhora Heloísa Esteves, diretor de estudos do petróleo, gás natural e biocombustíveis da empresa de pesquisa energética, a EPE.
Hi, thank you all for the invitation to be here today. I thank especially the Ministry of Mines and Energy and Itaipu Binational. It's an honor to join you all and to present Brazil's long-term energy plan for biogas, which is a part of our national energy plan towards 2050. Transitions in general are not linear processes. The energy transition process is associated with significant changes in the structure of the world's primary energy matrix. It's a complex process with high variations in stage and pace of transformations in different countries, regions, and locations. The current energy transition is based on conditions such as sustainable development, climate change, and technological innovations associated with electronics and the entry into the digital age. It's a transformation process towards a low carbon economy and a smaller environmental footprint based on incentives for a more efficient use of energy sources and for higher use of low carbon sources. In the Brazilian long-term energy plan, biofuels stand out. Bioenergy is seen as one of the most promising alternatives for our sustainable path towards a sustainable energy future. And biogas, it's one of our best bets to get there. Alessandro already mentioned the biogas sources in Brazil. We expect to reach up to 40 million cubic meters per day from sugarcane only by the end of this decade. Biogas has a growth potential both for transportation and for electricity generation. In the transportation sector, the demand for biofuels is expected to increase progressively due to the implementation of our national biofuels policy, RenovaBio, which came into force in early 2020. Biogas is one of the biofuels considered in the policy. Also, it will be part of a recently launched program, the Fuels of the Future program, or Combustível do Futuro. This program was created to propose policies to increase the use of sustainable low-carbon fuels in transportation, such as biogas. In the electricity sector, the new possibilities created by technological changes will significantly expand the offer of energy as a service. We expect higher decentralization. And although decentralization is usually associated with technological aspects of the electricity sector, there are also dimensions of this process that involve other sectors, especially biogas in small-scale plants, which represent a paradigm shift to this sector. This may be specifically relevant in the Brazilian context, given our great potential for urban agriculture waste. There's also a strong potential for expanding the production of biogas and biomethane from municipal waste. Increase will lead to greater offer of renewable energy inputs that can be directed into electricity generation. I would also like to point out that natural gas, reinforced and progressively replaced by biogas and biomethane, will have the role of integrating the technological paradigms of fossil fuels and renewables by enabling a greater introduction of non-dispatchable renewable sources into our electricity sector. We already have some Brazilian states with significant shares of biogas mixed into their natural gas distribution networks, and we expect this share to grow in a very fast pace. In a future where the world increases its efforts toward decarbonization, biogas will also benefit from the development of carbon capture and carbon storage solutions, since it can reach negative emissions. Finally, we see a role for biogas in our path towards hydrogen. Although the energetic use of hydrogen has been known for a long time, it is expected to accelerate and become a key fuel in the future. And biogas and biomethane can be used for the production of hydrogen and synthesis gas. And that alternative, we believe, will be especially attractive for transportation. Biogas is a key aspect of our long-term energy plan. It provides energy security and low emissions, a successful combination for any energy strategy. So it's one of our main components. It's one of the main components of our path towards the energy transition.
Excelente apresentação, Heloísa. Nesse momento, passa a palavra para a senhora Margarete Maria Gandini, coordenadora geral de fiscalização de regimes automotivos do Ministério da Economia, que irá apresentar o tema do biometano como combustível para frotas de veículos pesados.
Gostaria inicialmente de agradecer pelo convite para falar sobre as potencialidades e vantagens do uso do biometano no transporte de cargas e de passageiros. No Brasil, as políticas públicas dirigidas às indústrias de mobilidade e logística têm se voltado cada vez mais para uma logística e mobilidade verde, com, tanto pela adoção de combustíveis renováveis, quanto pela definição de metas cada vez maiores de eficiência energética dos veículos e de redução de emissões. O biometano é um combustível renovável. Nesse sentido, já temos iniciativa para desenvolvimento de motor a biogás de alta eficiência para veículos de transporte de carga, bem como a outra iniciativa denominada Corredores Sustentáveis, coordenada no âmbito do governo federal pela Secretaria Especial de Produtividade, Emprego e Competitividade do Ministério da Economia, em parceria com outros ministérios da Esplanada, e que se volta a construir soluções para a descarbonização do transporte, tendo por objetivo transformar as potencialidades das quais vamos falar neste momento em realidade. Nesse esforço, o governo federal tem contado sempre com a parceria do setor produtivo, respeitando a livre iniciativa para encontrar as melhores soluções para o país. No Brasil, o potencial de produção de biometano é de 80 milhões de metros cúbicos por dia, o que equivale a 44% da demanda total de óleo diesel no Brasil. Na Europa, esse potencial é de apenas 12%, com uma forte competição de outras aplicações. Ainda importa destacar que no Brasil, a principal fonte potencial de matéria-prima para a produção de biometano é o bagaço de cana-de-açúcar, que não concorre com a produção de alimentos. O biometano, nesse processo de descarbonização, ao se usar ele como combustível para transporte de cargas e de passageiros, tem o potencial de reduzir as emissões de gás carbônico em mais de 85%. Ainda, ele pode promover um processo rápido de descarbonização do transporte, pois ele está prontamente disponível, é escalonável, os investimentos em veículos de carga e rede de abastecimento do gás natural podem ser aproveitados também para o uso do biometano. A produção do biometano está na base de um processo de economia circular, onde a melhor maneira de reciclar os resíduos sólidos é a produção de gás renovável e de biofertilizantes. A tecnologia de uso de biometano no transporte, ele concorre com a eletrificação, tanto a bateria como a célula de hidrogênio, contudo, é mais barata. Os desafios que se colocam para essa transição é o estímulo à adoção de políticas públicas voltadas ao estímulo à produção, distribuição e uso de biometano como combustível de transporte. Nesse sentido, a elaboração de políticas coerentes em parceria com o setor privado para assegurar melhores modelos de negócios para investidores e o estímulo à viabilidade econômica da produção e uso do biometano é extremamente importante. Agradeço a todos pela atenção e um bom evento.
Thank you so much for your presentation, Margarete. It's really interesting to see how the sugarcane industry has lots to do with the transportation and also with the potential to produce internally national fuel with biomethane. Now we are coming to the end of our side event,
But before, we shall go through the questions that the participants have sent us. For that, I would like to invite Mr. Alessandro Gardman and Mrs. Eloisa Esteves and Felipe to re-enter the room to chat with us. Hello, y'all. Thank you.
Hi.
Thanks for stepping in. So let's go to the first question. The first question has to do with financing and funding, and is what's the current debt to income ratio in Brazil for sustainable and circular economy projects? And to add with that, is there a project financing rate for biogas enterprises? I guess this question has to do with the guarantee that a project of biogas needs and how much to debt to equity ratio it is found in the market. Who would like to answer this question?
Nicolas, can you repeat the last part of your question, because we lost it?
Yes, of course. The second part of the question is if there is a project financing rate, so interest rate, for biogas enterprises.
I believe I can collaborate here. There are specific financing lines from the Brazilian National Development Bank, BNDES, for biogas projects. Most of the funds come from the climate fund that's operationalized. I don't believe that word exists, but the Development Bank makes it operational, I think. So, but the specific rate and requirements can be found. It depends on the project and how much of the capex has to be can be financed. It depends on the project and on the company. The program itself, it encompasses several areas, so you can apply for urban mobility, for instance, biogas for urban mobility, climate change, renewable energies, and I believe most of the biogas projects fall into that. The maximum amount that can be financed, I believe it's about 30 million reais per year. But the specific of each project should be addressed directly by the bank.
And do you have knowledge of financing lines that finance 100% of the project, or the investor must come in with a percentage of equity in warranty?
I honestly don't know.
I don't think you can do 100% finance. No, I don't think that in Brazil you can do 100% finance. Here in Brazil, this is the biggest challenge we have in Brazil, is financing the projects. We have non-subsidized based projects, but we lack project finance. So I would say something around 70% debt to 30% equity would be needed, at least, plus some corporate guarantees for the debt. So this is, I mean, I think the biggest challenge that you're trying to work out here in Brazil, even trying to develop a guarantee fund to guarantee at least the debt. But this is the biggest challenge, especially because we are going to larger projects, more efficient projects, where the capex level is a little bit higher. So this is the challenge that we need to develop now. And you were asking about price. I would say that the biomethane here in Brazil, a tank station would cost something between $15 and $18 per million BTU, something around that. So extremely competitive, I would say, compared to diesel prices, or even LPG also. So really good option for this decarbonization for the Brazilian industry.
Okay, thank you for the insights on financing biogas projects in Brazil. Eloisa, there's a question here. I think that it would be on your side to answer. There has been some events on regulation, distributed regulation in Brazil, that might affect how biogas is monetized. Since biogas is a decentralized source of energy and can work off-grid, how do you see that biogas could in Portuguese would be a contornar? How do you see that biogas could profit from this change of regulation, meaning of the distributed regulation?
I don't know if I correctly understood the question. If the question is regarding the new gas law and the changes that came from that.
No, it's about electricity generation.
Oh, okay. So it's a change on regulation on the electricity side.
Yes.
Geração distribuída.
Yes.
Yes, okay. I believe biogas can benefit a lot from it, actually. Mostly, but not like in the conventional way, because the conventional way that you try to enter, and we have some projects of, you know, biogas on renewable auctions and coming from the incentives on distributed generation. Even with the changes regarding access to networks that might influence the way projects are built, I believe biogas has a lot to learn, because it can adapt itself and dispatch more easily than other sources. So I actually believe it's a matter of how to adapt and how to adjust projects to this new regulation that it's actually still to come, right? We actually don't quite know exactly the end of the discussion. So, yes. But I actually believe that biogas might benefit more than other renewable sources, because it has more flexibility to adapt to different tariffs, to hourly rates.
Yeah, if I can add something that to Eloisa's speech about the regulation, there is really a bigger number of possibilities to use the biogas to generate electricity for big size and small size biogas plants, and I think that the change will bring more maturity to the biogas sector. Also, considering, as Alessandro said before, projects connected with higher performance, higher technology, because it will be connected with different kind of contracts. So it will be good for the maturity of the biogas sector. And for the projects, small size projects and cooperative projects, collective projects, they can still participate on the generator and the electricity for biogas, with biogas economy, with no problems. Another thing that Eloisa said is about it's ongoing, the changes. This is the major problem. It is not like this, and it's not like that. So this, it's not good for the sector. This time discussing which will be the rules to make biogas for electricity. That's a huge problem than a change itself. So we hope that until the end of this year, we have this discussion ended, and we have and we know the rules for the new contracts on biogas for electricity.
Okay, I guess that's a good way to make good things out of the changing. Of the changing of the regulations, and it shows only that biogas dispatchability is a flexible thing to value. We have now a specific question here about the brewing industry or beer production. I know Felipe has visited some plants of beer production. Can you contribute a bit on the potential for this industry on biogas and biomethane?
Yes, Nicolas. We studied the brewery sector in Paraná State, and there is a lot of possibilities to produce biogas using the substrates that we have on brewery sector, and they also demand a lot of energy. So there is possibilities to have energy as a business for them, and also to increase competitiveness in their own business. So we studied the possibilities in small breweries, and big industry for the beer sector. There's a lot of possibilities there. They have a big demand on electricity, on heat, and also on CO2. So there is a lot of possibilities to use biogas in the brewery sector in Brazil. We should have a lot of projects on the brewery sectors in the next years. We have two projects in Brazil that already produce biogas in brewery. But in the both cases, they could produce more biogas and use it to increase their competitiveness in a better way. So it's a really nice market.
Okay, thank you very much, Felipe. And I guess that goes also with every big producing organic industry, as of breweries, for example. Before I pass the word to the panelists to do the final considerations, I would like to invite you to visit the website of the Unido project at Jeff Biogas Brazil at www.jeffbiogas.org.br, or if you prefer, please contact our team directly at contato@jeffbiogas.org.br. So now I'll give the microphone back to you for your final considerations, and we come to the end of the event. Please, Eloisa, you can start. Oh, and if I may, it would be nice if you guys could give from your perspective one important word or event that should occur in order for our sector to grow with acceleration.
Thank you, Nicolas. It's hard to be the first one, but we've heard lots of excellent commentaries on biogas use, its potential, and especially its potential if you think about the future, right? So biogas may benefit a lot from the energy transition process, and especially in Brazil, it has not only the potential to be produced, but a potential to growth. What are the challenges and what should we do to accelerate that? I think the first one would be to reduce the information asymmetry as a way to provide incentives to the sector. We believe that we can work a lot of quite a bit more on that. We need, from the government point of view, to better coordinate our public policies. See, we saw Ministry of Mines and Energy, Ministry of Economics, the Brazil Developing Bank, my institution, the Energy Research Office. There are lots of policies that could enhance the biogas potential. And what we're trying to do now, and we should do that, is to better coordinate them. The recent policy, it's all about that, you know, coordinating policies. I believe we must also, a way is to enhance R&D investments, specifically public-oriented R&D investments. And I'm talking not only the electricity sector, but especially the oil and gas companies. They should try to look a little bit more to invest their huge R&D potential in renewables, including biogas, and how to build new business models in order to you know, we heard a lot about the potential, but how do we make it concrete? I think those would be my three points, you know, reduce information asymmetry, better coordination of public policies from all sides, and R&D public-oriented investments. Thank you.
Right on. Thank you, Eloisa. Alessandro, your turn for the final considerations, please.
Brazil has the biggest untapped potential for biogas. We are not using, dismissing, wasting almost 70% of our diesel consumption equivalent with non-used organic waste. No competition with food at whatsoever, avoiding involuntary emissions. It's time to use it. Decarbonization with risk reduction, no risk, no drilling risk, extremely important for the Brazilian economy to achieve its potential. So I thank you all and congratulations for your organization, and it's a pleasure to be here, guys.
Thank you, Alessandro. Felipe, please.
Thank you, Nicolas. We can do in Brazil a decarbonization agenda really connected with business. There is a lot of new business going on, a new market going on, and a big number of possibilities to increase our competitiveness as an as the Brazilian agro industry is, specifically, and connect the decarbonization agenda with business, not with costs, with business. There is a lot of things that we can do, and there is a lot of things that we can make happen doing green business. So this is why Brazil has a very attractive agenda on biogas and biomethane, and nowadays we are discussing a lot of the ESG agenda, and I have to say that biomethane is unbeatable on ESG agenda. There is a lot of good possibilities when we consider the use of the biomethane and the biogas in your industry. So let's use it, let's make it happen. Let's decarbonize Brazil.
Okay, thank you very much, Felipe. It was very clear that the time is here to make it happen. Well, we come to the end. I would like to thank you all participants and panelists. and by the name of the Ministério de Minas e Energia, Itaipu Binacional and CI Biogás for the important participation in our in this event, and also our special thanks to the United Nations organization for the opportunity to talk about biogas and biomethane on this high level. Bye-bye.